Gerry Weber for the plaintiff, along with my client Nydia Tisdale. Your Honor, this is an Open Meetings Act case, and it really kind of honors the phrase "timing is everything." And what we've got here on the screen and before Your Honor is what we think are the key events, and I'm going to kind of walk through them. And the reason I say timing is everything is because there's two aspects of timing that are really critical here. One is on the day when the Cumming City Council, from our position, approved this real estate transaction, which is identified in the documents as the Pilgrim Ridge Subdivision. On that day, prior to the meeting, the governor signed the new Open Meetings Act, and he signed it effective immediately. So it came into play on the day of the Cumming City Council meeting, but before that meeting, and there's a stipulation in the record about that. Second important aspect of timing is that our position is that the mayor entered into this real estate transaction for this Pilgrim Ridge subdivision before the city council approved it. So it's kind of a cart before the horse thing. The approval has to precede the deal, and here the deal preceded the purchase. And so there's a problem under the Open Meetings Act and the city charter. And there's really sort of four events on this chart here. First is there's an executive session, and we're going to talk a bit about that. We're going to look at the minutes from the executive session and the minutes from the meeting on March 20th.
Well, just before you go any further, I'm looking through the file now, and I see something here that's marked judge's copy. Is that mine?
I sent an extra courtesy copy for Your Honor.
I did not get it. That may be it.
This is it. I'm not sure what you did.
Okay. All right, go ahead now.
So there's this March 20th meeting of the Cumming City Council where they go into an executive session to discuss some transactions, some real estate matters. Then on April 16th, the mayor enters into the deal for one of these matters, the Pilgrim Ridge subdivision, as it's described in the documents. After that, on April 17th, the governor signs a new law, and then, after the deal was entered into, the city council approves the deal. And by the way, escorts Miss Nydia Tisdale out when she videotapes that meeting, and that leads
to... I'm going to object to this. That allegation is part of a separate lawsuit that Miss Tisdale has brought against the city of Cumming. It was not part of the facts that were alleged in this case. It's not an issue that's before this court. What we're dealing with before this court is the real estate transaction that the plaintiff has complained about. It's not even in the pleadings. It's not even in the complaint.
I agree, Your Honor. I was just giving you the back. That's
fine. Right, go ahead. Sure. Go ahead. I hope I can separate out what I need to know. Go ahead.
So then, on April 17th, the deal is approved by the Cumming City Council. So it's a cart before the horse problem. The deal is entered into before the city council approves the deal. And there's a key case from the Georgia Supreme Court called H. B. Brown v. Villarica, which is 278 Georgia 819, and both sides talk about it in the briefs. It's a 2005 case from the Georgia Supreme Court that says that if a council approves their contract after the contract's been entered into, it's null and void, both because it violates the Open Meetings Act, because you didn't approve it in a public meeting, and because there it violated the Villa Rica city charter. And I'll talk about the Cumming city charter in a little bit. So our position is that the Villa Rica case is the key case. Basically says, if you're going to have some kind of deal, a contract, a land purchase, whatever, council has to approve it before you do it. Now, there's four key documents, and these are all on the record, but I thought I would have these for your honor to look at and to think about as we're going through, because there's other documents that are in the record that I think are less important. The first is the minutes, and your honor, if I may approach.
Sure.
This is exhibit one. This is the minutes from the March 20th meeting, the first meeting. And the key language is on the last page of that. Section Roman numeral 5, executive session. It just says, Mayor Gravitt announced the need for an executive session to discuss issues concerning the purchase of real property. So that's going to be the key language we're going to talk about in that document. The second document is, this was attached to the defendant's brief, it's Plaintiff's Exhibit 2, and these are some redacted minutes that actually we had requested under the Open Records Act and were never produced to us, but were ultimately produced in this litigation. The redacted minutes of that executive session on March 20th. And we're going to talk about those in a little bit. Third document, which we marked as Plaintiff's Exhibit 3, and these were attached to the plaintiff's complaint, are just the documents about the deal. And they're dated and filed with the clerk's office on April 16th. And then the fourth document, and this is the last one, sorry to figure I'd give them to you, Your Honor, at the beginning.
That's fine.
Is the agenda and minutes from, and this is Plaintiff's Exhibit 4, of the April 17th meeting.
Can we consider that all these exhibits are admitted?
Your Honor, we have certified copies of the exhibits, which is actually what the law would require for the court to consider them. We intend to introduce them during our presentation. I've not looked at these. I have the certified official minutes here as the law.
Why don't you make sure we get these in before we adjourn?
Sure, absolutely, Your Honor. So these are the key documents. Now our argument's really simple. On March 20th, the City Council approved an executive session to discuss certain unnamed real estate transactions. Then they discuss it. On April 16th, the mayor enters into this deal about the Pilgrim Ridge subdivision, and then after that, a day later, the council approves it. Cart before the horse problem, prohibited by this Villa Rica case, because you have to have the council approval before the deal. Now, the city has a different argument. They say on this first day, March 20th, 2012, they approved that deal. They didn't just discuss it, they approved it, even though no terms had been decided at that point. Now, if Your Honor would look at Plaintiff's Exhibit 1, the executive session minutes, the minutes of the public meeting that described the executive session, it says, Mayor Gravitt announced the need for an executive session to discuss issues concerning the purchase of real property. That's all it says. Now there's a key code section here under the old Open Meetings Act, because that meeting was governed by the old Open Meetings Act. And actually the language doesn't change, but I'm just trying to be clear. It's 50-14-4A.
50-14-4A.
Yeah. And it says, in order to go into an executive session, The minutes need to reflect the, quote, specific reasons for closure. And two, the vote must identify, quote, the names of those present and the names of those voting for closure. So two requirements. Each specific reason for the executive session has to be described in the minutes. And each person voting for the closure has to be described in the public minutes. And Your Honor, that's really important. And the Supreme Court has emphasized how important it is to identify who was voting for what in 2012. There's the case of CARDINALE. This guy filed a lawsuit pro se, no lawyer. He goes all the way to the Georgia Supreme Court, and he argues that if a decision is made without identifying who cast the votes, it's a violation of the Open Meetings Act. And he wins without a lawyer in the Georgia Supreme Court in 2012.
What's that case?
290 Georgia 521. And it's cited in our briefs. And that section of the Open Meetings Act was actually ambiguous as to whether you have to identify how each person casts their vote. It was a different section of the Open Meetings Act that was kind of fuzzy about whether you have to say, Joe voted yes, Sam voted no. Nevertheless, given the broad construction of the open meetings law, the Georgia Supreme Court says you got to include the names and the votes of everybody. There's two attorney general opinions, one of which we cited in our briefs, and one of which I discovered in the last week, in all honesty, Your Honor.
Well, I don't have a copy of your brief, so.
It's in the reply brief.
I have that. It's in here.
It should be in the record, Your Honor, yeah.
Is the other side's brief in here, too?
It should be.
It's certainly in the record, Your Honor.
Well, I want you all to be sure that I get all of this before I leave. I don't see it, frankly.
It would have been dated...
I got plaintiff's reply brief.
That's it, Your Honor.
I don't know that I have the defense. Go ahead. We'll take care of all this when we finish.
So there's two attorney general opinions, one in 1988, which is cited in our brief, 1988 Attorney General Opinion 147. 10 years later, also interpreting the same provision that we're talking about, 5014-4A, and I didn't cite this one in the brief, this was the one that I found recently, Your Honor. It's 1998 Opinion Attorney General 145. Both of these cases interpret this provision, 50, or Attorney General opinions, I'm sorry, 5014-4A. And both of them say it means what it says. You have to be specific in the public minutes as to each transaction that's discussed, and you have to reflect the votes cast by everybody. Now let's look back at this language in Exhibit 1. It says, Mayor Gravitt announced the need for an executive session to discuss issues concerning the purchase of real estate property. Doesn't reflect a vote at all. It says, Mayor Gravitt announced the need for an executive session. There's no evidence in these minutes, as the statute requires, that there was even a vote taken. And certainly no evidence that, you know, Councilman 1 said yes, Councilman 2 said yes. So one reason that these public minutes from the executive session is deficient is because it doesn't identify that a vote was taken or how each person cast their vote. That's not the only problem with this, Your Honor. The statute, again, 5014-4A, says that the specific reasons for closure have to be identified. This just says concerning the purchase of real estate property. One piece of property, five pieces of property, seven pieces of property, we have no idea. We do have an idea when we look at Plaintiff's Exhibit 2. We see in those redacted minutes that there was not one thing discussed in executive session. Not two things discussed in executive session, not three, not four, but five. This was fifth on the list. So there were five things apparently discussed in the executive session. What the other four were, I have no idea, because we don't have them. But what we do know is that the minutes, Plaintiff's Exhibit 1, does not specifically identify each thing that was going to be talked about in that executive session. The whole purpose of the Open Meetings Act is to ensure sunshine on meetings. Now, there are these narrow executive session matters. But the way to keep the public at least partially informed is this statute upon which we rely on, 5014-4. It ensures that at least the public knows how people voted to go into that executive session, and at least knows the, quote, specific reasons for closure. Now, that becomes even more important when you focus on the case that the defendants primarily rely upon. The old open meetings law, which was in effect at this March 20th meeting, the very beginning of this timeline, specifically provided in 5015.3 that you could have discussion of real estate matters in executive session. But the statute at that time was silent as to whether you could vote in executive session on a real estate transaction.
It's 15.15.3?
Yeah. Okay. New law actually makes it very clear. You can discuss in an executive session, but you have to vote in a public meeting. So old law, you could possibly discuss and vote in an executive session on a real estate transaction. Old law. New law, you have to have the vote in a public place. Now, there's a case that the defendants focus on. It's Johnson versus Board of Commissioners of Bibb County. It's 302 Georgia App 266. 302 Georgia App 266. It's a 2010 case. They are correct that that case holds that under the old open meetings law, the court interprets the statute to allow for both discussion and voting on a real estate transaction in an executive session. If Two things. If the Open Meetings Act otherwise allows, and as we've discussed, the Open Meetings Act didn't allow them to do it in the way that they do it, because they didn't identify each of the five things they were going to be discussing, they didn't reflect that there was even a vote taken or who cast the votes. And if the city charter allowed, and we've cited in our brief, the Cumming City Charter actually requires that all matters that are decided by the city council occur in a public meeting. That's section 10 of the city charter. So even though Johnson allowed for, under the Open Meetings Act, maybe a vote under the old law for a real estate transaction in an executive session, city charter didn't allow that. City charter went beyond the Open Meetings Act and required that all votes be taken in a public place. It's a very good provision of the city charter.
What's the city charter's the code of section?
Your Honor, it is subsection 10, and it says council shall exercise its powers only in public meetings. City Charter Part 1, Section 10. Now, one other thing I think is important as we're thinking about that very first meeting, because we're right now just still in that first meeting. Let's look at these executive session minutes. This is the second document that I gave Your Honor, Plaintiff's Exhibit 2. This is from March 20th. So, you know, they go into executive session. Whether they voted or not, we have no idea. All we know from the minutes is that the mayor announced, because the minutes are fatally flawed. But when we get to these minutes, and they're redacted, so we've only got one part of it, again, we see that this is number five on a list. So apparently there were four other matters discussed. Doesn't say that in the public minutes, as the law requires, but apparently there were four other matters discussed. Well, let's get to number five, which is this, the Pilgrim Mill issue. You look at the end of it, it says the council authorized the mayor to attempt to negotiate and close a contract on behalf of the city for less than appraised value. Apparently, it's very early on in the negotiation process. Price hasn't been determined, terms haven't been determined. So, as I read that those minutes, even if you rejected all of my argument so far, even if you said, well, the Open Meetings Act doesn't mean what it says, it doesn't really mean that you have to have a vote in the minutes, it doesn't really mean you have to have the votes of every person who was voting, it doesn't really mean you have to have the specific reasons. Even if you rejected everything I've said so far, look at that. It doesn't say we approve a transaction. It says attempt to negotiate. None of the terms have been determined. There's a lot to be done. That's why, kind of moving down the timeline, they do ultimately approve the deal later on. Because at a later point, they did determine the price, the terms. The only problem is the mayor approved the deal before the city council voted. That's a big problem. That's a cart before the horse problem. So our argument is really simple, Your Honor. Cart before the horse. They have a meeting, they say, let's go into executive session and discuss this. Okay, Mayor, go ahead and see if you can get a deal struck. Mayor gets a deal struck. Problem for Mayor is that he entered into the deal before the city council approved it. Then the city council approves it. And Villaricker says that that is improper. Now, the city's going to argue, I know that they're going to argue that in that March 20th meeting, in that executive session, in the dark, outside of public view, they approved, without any terms determined at that time, they approved a deal when they didn't have the price, when they didn't have the terms of the deal, that they just gave, kind of gave the mayor in a silent, secret meeting, back doors, carte blanche, to do whatever he wanted, as long as he met their narrow scope of authorization. Now you gotta ask yourself, why then do they reapprove it later on? And ultimately, there's three problems with their argument. They didn't go into the executive session properly. They failed in that. That fatally flaws them. Second is, that executive session looks like all it says is you can discuss, you can try to get a deal struck, but you got to bring it back to us.
And the third terms, it says and close a contract. What is that?
And close a contract.
Yeah.
I'm not really sure what that means. What I do know is that the public meeting minutes say that they only approved his discussion. They didn't say vote. So on Plaintiff's Exhibit 1, it doesn't say we're going into executive session to vote on real estate transactions. It says we're going into executive session to discuss real estate transactions. And that Johnson case that they're going to rest their whole argument on makes a big distinction between discussion and voting. They're two very dramatically different things. And the Cumming City Charter says you can't even have an executive session where you vote on anything. You got to have decisions made in a public meeting. So, Your Honor, our ultimate remedy here is what Villarica says, that the transaction is null and void, that the city can go back and have a public meeting and approve a transaction, and then they can approve a deal if they can reach the terms. That's the kind of remedy that the Georgia Supreme Court has imposed in these open meetings cases. The Debs case is, I think, the most recent case where they did that. And they basically said, okay, you got to go back and do this properly in a public meeting. You got to have a vote. You got to have then enter into a transaction correctly. And the other two parts of the case are, under the Open Meetings Act, we're entitled to reasonable attorney's fees if we prevail. And now, under the new act, there's these civil penalties that are based upon an individual violation. And we can address those if we reach that point, Your Honor.
All right, now specifically, what are you asking me the court to do?
To find that the transactions, which are all reflected in Plaintiff's Exhibit 3, that the transaction for the Pilgrim Ridge subdivision is, as the Villa Rica case upon which we rely, that you would declare it null and void. That's the first thing. That you would require them to have a public meeting and prior to entering into any deal, which is what the proper remedy is in open meetings cases. And then just the reasonable attorney's fees and the civil penalty, which is a pretty modest civil penalty that's set out in the statute.
Okay, thank you. Tal?
Judge, before we go any farther, I'd move for a directed verdict on plaintiff's claims regarding the Cumming City Charter. The law requires the plaintiff to meet its burden, has to plead and prove what the Cumming City Charter says. They have not produced a certified copy of the Cumming City Charter. That is not something that the court is allowed to take judicial notice of. And based upon that, we'd move for a directed verdict. Actually, because we don't have a jury, it's technically a motion to dismiss with prejudice at this point because the plaintiff has failed to, in any of their briefs, in their presentation today, or any of their argument, produce a certified copy of the Cumming City Charter.
Your Honor, we would disagree with that. It is a law. You can take judicial notice of a law. You can take notice of a statute. You can take notice of a constitutional amendment. You can take notice of a case. This is a provision of the law. We don't have to provide a copy of a law that is certified. Otherwise, I'd have to provide you with a copy of each one of these statutes as a certified copy. That's not the law.
It is a law, Judge, and the reason it's the law is because the statutes that Mr. Weber has been citing to, they're in a compilation called the Official Code of Georgia Annotated that you, I, any lawyer can go to our bookshelf and pull it off and actually take a look at it. The City of Cumming Charter was a local act passed by the General Assembly subject to modification through home rule by the City of Cumming. It's just like any other ordinance. Plaintiff failed to produce a certified copy of it. Plaintiff can't have its relief based upon it because the court's not allowed to take judicial notice of the charter.
Well, obviously I'm not going to rule on that at this moment without looking into it.
And Your Honor, we'd be happy to provide you with a certified copy of the charter. I don't believe it's necessary, but we're happy to do that. We're just looking for justice here. We're not focusing on that. I think you don't need judicial. You can take judicial notice.
I think you made your point, Mr. Tallant, and whatever you say from now on does not weigh that issue that you raised.
Thank you, Judge. If you don't mind, because I've got.
Oh, sure.
I'm sorry. Thank you, Your Honor. I appreciate that.
Because I
would point out that plaintiff asked for this to be the final hearing on this case. And I do believe it would be inappropriate for the court to leave evidence open since this is now the final hearing at plaintiff's request on this matter. I think it would be inappropriate for the court to leave evidence open for the plaintiff to come back and supplement its record that it failed to present this all this information to begin with.
Mr. Weber, you go ahead and send it to me, but it's subject again to the objection.
Certainly. Thank you, Your Honor.
Your Honor, I've prepared a presentation that I think will help the court see the flaws in the plaintiff's case.
Have you got a copy of all this for me?
I can. None of it's evidence. I can certainly get you a copy if I hear a copy.
Well,
is your monitor on, Judge?
Yeah, I see it right.
Okay. Well, but this has my notes on it, and it's not.
Oh, you can mail it to me.
Thank you, Judge.
Go ahead.
First of all, let me tell you, I want to thank you for coming here, Judge. We have these cases from time to time where our local judges, for whatever reason, believe they can't sit And if you weren't willing to come here, then our entire justice system would grind to a halt in cases like this. So thank you very much.
Well, we all have a problem anyway. You take Hall and Dawson County, they've got four judges, and you all have been living with two. How you've been able to do it, I don't know. Your judges have done yeoman-like work to even try to keep up with the business that they have to do, and so they needed help. Unfortunately, you got a third judge, but you need another one.
We did. Thank you, Judge. I mean, I know that they will appreciate hearing that you said that. Your Honor, I want to go over briefly the background facts that Mr. Weber mentioned, but as a court would expect, the city of Cumming has a little bit of a different view as to what went on. First, the entire case is about plaintiff's challenge of a 77-acre tract of land, and it does involve two meetings, and the plaintiff is right. It's the first meeting was on March 20th, 2012, where it is our position that in executive session, authorization was given for Mayor Gravitt to attempt to negotiate and close on a contract to purchase property. That property was then purchased on April 16th of 2012, and then on April 17th, 2012, one day later, the purchase was brought to the attention of public and a subsequent vote was taken on that exact same purchase.
Was it purchased for less than $50,000 an acre?
It absolutely was, Your Honor. The plaintiff has brought two claims. One is violation of the Georgia Open Meetings Act. And I'm going to give you the roadmap of where I'm going, Judge, so that you can see the structure of my argument. First issue on that is, number one, statute of limitations. Plaintiff's claim fails for the statute of limitations. Plaintiff's claim fails for the fact that there is simply no violation of the Georgia Open Meetings Act in this case, as I will be explaining. The second was the compliance of the city charter. I've already made my initial threshold objection that the court can't take judicial notice and the plaintiff has to specifically provide a certified copy of the charter, which would have been self-authenticating had the plaintiff gotten a certified copy of the charter. They failed to do so. That's the threshold defense. The second defense is standing in this matter for the plaintiff to bring a claim on the charter. And then again, as in the Open Meetings Act, there's simply no violation here.
Well, let me ask you this.
Yes, sir.
Ms. Tisdale, a resident of Forsyth County?
She is not. She is not a resident of Forsyth County. She, in fact, according to the pleading that she filed in this court, lives in the city of Roswell. And the court's already picked up on one of the arguments I'm going to make later on. It would be like allowing a citizen of the state of Alabama to bring an action against the state of Georgia for violation of the one subject rule. A citizen of the state of Alabama doesn't have standing to bring an action against the state of Georgia for violation of the one subject rule unless they're specifically harmed by it. Ms. Tisdale is not a citizen of Forsyth County, is not a citizen of the state of Georgia, and as she filed in this court, she is a citizen of the state of Georgia, not a citizen of Forsyth County, not a citizen of the city of Cumming. She instead, as she indicated in the pleading that she filed pro se, is a citizen of the city of Roswell. Turning first to our Open Meetings Act claim and the statute of limitations defense, Your Honor, here's what the statute of limitations provides. To set aside an action, the defendant has 90 days from when the action was taken to bring an action regarding it, but there's a discovery rule. So if for some reason she didn't discover the violation of the Open Meetings Act, she would have 90 days from when the action should have been discovered in order to bring an action based upon the Open Meetings Act.
When was this suit filed?
This suit was filed in October, Your Honor, of 2012, and I'm going to be hitting on that. The plaintiff, in his reply brief, argues that this case is actually subject to a statute of repose. Plaintiff has confused, Your Honor, the six-month statute of repose with the 90-day statute of limitations. And these are in here for good reason, Judge. I mean, when we have local governments that are taking action, we don't want people to sit around and months later start challenging them, upsetting everything that has been placed in motion by the city of Cumming or by any local government, because that's going to upset the entire local government system, and we'll have actions that have been taken months down the road being set aside.
Right. And I hate to argue that, to interrupt you, I'm sorry.
You're fine, Judge.
But the code sections that deal with the statute of limitations defense, can you tell me what those are?
Off the top of my head, I cannot, but they are in our brief.
Okay. In your brief, that's all right.
I
haven't gotten your brief, but I'll get it.
I apologize, Your Honor. It's in the record. We will make sure you have a copy of our brief.
Go ahead.
The code sections are cited, Judge. Anytime you're analyzing a statute of limitations defense, the question is, when did the clock start? In our position, there are two dates it could be. One, April 6th. These dates really don't make a difference, as the court will see, but one would be April 16th. That's the closing on the transaction. That's when these records were recorded in the real property records of Forsyth County made public. But give her the benefit of the doubt. Say it's April 17th. That's the meeting that Ms. Tisdale was at, where this was discussed, and where Mayor Gravitt, in public open session, notorious to everyone, said that we have purchased this property. And then there was that ratification vote that was taken to ratify the previous action taken. Give her the benefit of a doubt. Say it's April 17th, 2012. Plaintiff filed this action 178 days after April 17th, 2012. Almost double the length of what the statute of limitations would allow in this case. Her claim is barred. There's another quick way to look at it that I think really emphasizes how far the plaintiff missed the statute of limitations. Here we have the April 16th actions. There are the April 17th actions. Again, the purchase on April 16th, the meeting where the ratification vote for the action previously taken was done on April 17th. 90 days from those two, because of the way we calculate time in the state of Georgia regarding legal matters, either way, it's going to be Monday, July 16th, 2012. Plaintiff filed her action on Friday, October 12th of 2012. 3 months late is how late the plaintiff was in this case in bringing this action. Again, I mentioned that the plaintiff in her reply brief wants to argue that we should apply the statute of repose in this case. And what the statute of repose would say is that, well, the absolute drop dead date is October 15th, 2012, but the court knows that a statute of repose is the outside bar. Statute of limitations is one bar, statute of repose is a second bar. For the plaintiff to be able to take advantage of that statute of repose, she has to show that if you take the statute of repose date, October 15th, 2012, and then you back up 90 days, that for some reason she could not discover these violations that were in meetings that she is in a meeting she was present at, and that was recorded in the real property records of Forsyth County. She has to be able to show that for some reason she didn't see the facts that happened in this case that would lead her to the conclusion that a violation had occurred. That date was Tuesday, July 17th, 2012. In other words, a plaintiff, Your Honor, has to come forward in this case with some reason that between April 17th, 2012 and July 17th, 2012, even though she was in attendance, as Mr. Weber indicated, when the actions were taking place to ratify the purchase, she has to come up with some reason that she should not have, her clock had not already started to file suit. Nothing has been presented by the plaintiff in this case to show why she should be able to take advantage of any discovery rule, much less a discovery rule that would delay the start of her statute of limitations clock to Tuesday, July 17th, 2012. The plaintiff's claim fails under the Open Meetings Act based upon the statute of limitations. It also fails because it's barred by the fact of no violation. And I think that one of the easiest ways to look at this, Your Honor, and I agree with Mr. Weber on this, is to put it on a timeline. And here's the timeline that we've set up. The three key dates, March 20th, 2012, April 16th, 2012, and April 17th, 2012. Here are the actions that took place. March 20th, City Council authorizes the mayor to negotiate and close on the purchase of the property. There's a closing of the property on April 16th, 2012, and the City Council ratified the purchase previously authorized on April 17th, 2012. Here's the law that was applying. March 20th, 2012, there's an open meetings law of 1988, most recently amended in 2006. That's important for a reason I'll point out in a second. April 16th of 2012, we're still under the same Open Meetings Act. The law of 1988, recently amended as late as 2006. And then on April 17th, 2012, open meetings law, the new one, became effective. 4/17/2012. The prior version of the Open Meetings Act allowed the City of Cumming and any local government in the state of Georgia to vote on the purchase of property in executive session. Plaintiff is right. We are going to rely on Johnson versus Bibb County Board of Commissioners because, given the similarity of the facts, we'd be crazy not to. Johnson versus Bibb County Board of Commissioners, which is cited in our brief, but if the court wants to know it, it's 302 Georgia App 266. It's a 2010 case. The reason I mentioned this earlier, that the most recent revisions to the Open Meetings Act before the 2012 revisions were in 2006, because I want the court to know that the Johnson case is in fact interpreting the law that was applicable to the city of Cumming on March 20th, 2012. The law did not change between 2006 and 2012, and Johnson was decided in 2010. Here's what the Johnson versus Bibb County Board of Commissioners case said. Held, unless there is an exception to the Open Meetings Act that specifically provides that a vote on an accepted issue must be taken in public, a vote may be taken in executive session. Here's what else they held. I can't figure out how the plaintiff is missing this point in this case. Bibb County did not violate the Open Meetings Act when it went into executive session to discuss real property acquisition and then voted in executive session to authorize a real estate transaction. Now, the reason I draw attention to the word discuss, Judge, is because on the very first page of the case, at least in the way that it printed off, and Your Honor, I have copies of the cases for you. Oh, here it is. Do you have a copy of this, Jamie?
Yeah.
Here's a copy of the Bibb County case, Your Honor. If the court looks at the bottom of this paragraph right here at the bottom of the page, what Bibb County did was they said, we're going to go into executive session to discuss real property acquisition. And later in executive session, they voted to acquire real property. They did it two times, Judge. They went into executive session for the purpose of discussing real property acquisition, and then in executive session, they went beyond that. They voted on it. And this case, Johnson versus Bibb County Board of Commissioners says, that's fine. Now, why would a local government, when it is going to go into executive session for this purpose, announce going into executive session that it's going in there for the purpose of discussing real property acquisition? And the reason is that's because that's the way the law was written. The law was written to say you can go into executive session to discuss real property acquisition. That's what local governments announced they're going to do. That's what they went into executive session to do. Notably, and contrary to Mr. Weber's argument, nowhere in this does the Court of Appeals say, Bibb County, shame on you. You should have specifically identified the map and parcel number of the particular tract you're trying to purchase. Nowhere does it say that Bibb County, you have to discuss purchase of this particular tract of land. And why is that? It's not written in the code, Judge, but there's a great policy reason for it. If a local government is going to go in with public treasury to buy a piece of property, we don't want to give the world notice we're considering buying this property or condemning this property, because then the price goes through the roof. It's an effort to protect the public treasury that we don't have to come out and say, we're going to purchase the 77 acres of Jorwell property that's located on Pilgrim Mill Road. It's just not required. It's not required in the statute. It's not required in the Johnson versus Bibb County Board of Commissioners case. And it wasn't required of the city of Cumming. Now that we know the status of the law, let's look at the action that was taken. March 20th, 2012, the City of Cumming, in its regularly scheduled monthly meeting, at the end of the meeting, Mayor Gravitt announced the executive session to discuss potential land acquisitions, virtually identical to what the Court of Appeals noted in the Bibb County case. Mr. Weber wants to talk about how the executive session vote wasn't specifically recorded to note the name of each and every person who voted for and against it. Reason for that, simple. It was unanimous. The Cardinale case that he cited to the court dealt with a situation where 8 members voted one way and 7 members voted another way, but the votes weren't recorded. That's not what we're dealing with here. We're dealing with a council that voted unanimously. Every single person who was there voted in favor of it. That's why you don't have to go through, and there's actually in the Cardinale case, it talks about how if there's a non-roll call vote, there is a presumption that it was unanimous, and in fact, the City of Cumming minutes reflect that the vote was unanimous.
Where?
In the...
Not on plaintiff's 2.
Here we have a certified minutes, Your Honor, and I see what we're dealing with. It's the last version, it's the last portion of the minutes where there is the unanimous vote to adjourn, and it's actually reflecting what was done after the council meeting.
Okay.
Excuse me, Your Honor, is there additional language that was not in the...
No, there's not.
Okay.
Okay, go ahead.
Then in executive session, here's what happened. Discussion was held regarding the use of the property. Discussion was held regarding the price of the property. Action. The council gave Mayor H. Ford Gravitt direction to, quote, attempt to negotiate and close a contract on behalf of the city for less than the appraised value. All those actions are proper under Johnson versus Board of Commissioners of Bibb County. The plaintiff made a point in his argument that, and I want to make sure the court understands why this is the case, that he made a point that they had requested these executive session minutes previously and that they weren't produced. Well, it's not that we were hiding the ball. It's that the law of the state of Georgia says if you're, and that was not a request in discovery, Your Honor. That was a request under the Open Records Act. The law of the state of Georgia says that we don't have to produce minutes of executive session. And so it wasn't that we were hiding the ball. It's not that we were hiding things. It's that they're not required to be produced, and that's why they were not produced. So we have the meeting, we have the executive session, we have the presumption that if there's not an announcement of the vote, it's unanimous. Executive session was held, discussion was held regarding the use of the property, and action was given by the mayor to the mayor to attempt to negotiate and close a contract on behalf of the city for less than the appraised value. I'm gonna get to in a second what close on a contract or attempt to negotiate and close means, but that's the action that was taken right now. April 16th, pursuant to the direction given by council, Mayor Gravitt closed on the property, and on April 16th as well, the deeds were recorded. We moved to April 17th. This is the second day of the meeting. Status of the law on April 17th actually highlights the deficiencies in the plaintiff's case. Rather than supporting the plaintiff, these actually highlight the deficiencies in the plaintiff's case. Governor Deal signs a new open meetings law, and the new law says that when purchasing real estate from April 17th forward to be binding on the city on or after April 17th, the vote would have to be approved in public. April 17th, the action that was taken was in an open meeting, ratification of the previous action. Here's what action, more importantly, was not taken on April 17th. No vote or authorization regarding this transaction in executive or closed session. No discussion of this matter in executive session. Nothing with respect to this matter that was not open, public, and notorious on April 17th. No violation of the act. The key, Judge, and why I say that the change in the law actually highlights the plaintiff's problem in their case is that after April 17th, you would have to take this vote in executive session before it could be binding on the city. But everything was done, and the purchase was completed under the old version of the Open Meetings Act. The plaintiff has, in its reply brief, has tried to turn this issue of the City of Cumming taking a vote in April as to some kind of an admission that its March vote wasn't proper. That's what the plaintiff is trying to do, is show that somehow this March vote wasn't proper by the mere fact that the city took a vote in April. When in truth, Judge, in April, the city was just following the path that was laid for it by the Johnson versus Bibb County Board of Commissioners case. All the city did was go out and say, we're gonna follow Johnson, and after the acquisition of the property, we're gonna bring it up in public. They went a step further, because in the Johnson case, Bibb County waited until after suit was filed before it ratified the purchase. The city of Cumming went ahead and ratified the purchase without anybody having to file a lawsuit first. Turning to the charter issue, in addition to the objection we've already made, the plaintiff lacks standing because she cannot show an injury. Plaintiff is not a party to the agreement. In the H.G. Brown Bell RICA case that the plaintiff cites so much in its brief, the two parties to the agreement were the City of Bell RICA and the H.G. Brown Family Limited Partnership. City of Bell RICA was trying to get out of its contract. And so it said, we don't want to be bound by this H.G. Brown Family Limited Partnership, so we're not going to abide by it. The plaintiff in that case was the H.G. Brown Family Limited Partnership. They were a party to the contract. They had a direct injury in that case. Plaintiff can't pin her standing on that. She's not a party to the contract to purchase this property.
I'm going to show you my ignorance. What county is Roswell in?
Fulton.
Oh. I stayed north of Gainesville as much as I can. Okay, go ahead.
The allegation in this case is that the actions of the City of Cumming exceeded its power and are thus void. Standing in such cases, Your Honor, are given to citizens, residents, and taxpayers of the City of Cumming. That would be the Newsom versus City of Union Point case, and the site for that is 249 Georgia 434, 249 Georgia 434.
Got it.
That's a 1982 case, and then City of Atlanta versus North by Northwest Civic Association, 262 Georgia 531. That's a 1992 case. Standing is on plaintiff to prove that she has some reason to bring an action in this case. She's not done it. Nothing to show that she can either bring it as a citizen, resident, taxpayer of the City of Cumming, and nothing to show that she was a party to the agreement. As I mentioned in her pleading that she filed, she disclosed that she was a citizen of the City of Roswell. The court asked me, you know, where is Roswell located? And I told the court it's in Fulton County. It would actually be upon the plaintiff to prove that Roswell was located in either in Forsyth County or in the City of Cumming, because remember, we're dealing with the City of Cumming, not even Forsyth County here. Finally, the plaintiff cannot, Your Honor, bootstrap, and I think this is what they're going to try and argue that she can do, the plaintiff cannot bootstrap her open meeting standing into a standing for a charter challenge, because to have standing, someone has to prove an injury. They have to be injured. The Open Meetings Act specifically would give plaintiffs standing to make a challenge under the Open Meetings Act. But she can't then use that to also say, I have been injured by a charter violation. That would be like Mr. Miles and I leaving today, getting in a car and driving down Highway 20, and we're hit by someone. And I sue someone for my injuries. I sue the tortfeasor for my injuries. And while I'm at it, I sue the tortfeasor for Mr. Miles' injuries. Mr. Miles' injuries, although he's a friend of my partner, I don't have a claim for Mr. Miles' injuries. I only have a claim for my injuries. And that's why the plaintiff can't say, I've got this standing on this Open Meetings Act issue, but I'm also going to bring the claim of citizens, residents, and taxpayers in the City of Cumming. She can't do that, just like I can't sue for Mr. Miles' injuries in my hypothetical car crash case. Just because she has one kind of claim does not mean she has another kind of claim against the City of Cumming. Turning to the case that the plaintiff relies upon, the H.G. Brown Family Limited Partnership case for the City of Villa Rica, here is how grossly different that case is from this one. Municipalities are creatures of the General Assembly, and they are only vested with the power that the General Assembly gives them. And in H.G. Brown, the Villa Rica Charter gave Villa Rica the power to contract, but it said, Villa Rica, if you want a contract, there are three things that's got to be done. Number one, signed by the mayor after approval of the council. Number two, approved by a quorum of the council. And number three, the contract has to be drafted by the city attorney or submitted to him. That's what we're dealing with in the Villa Rica charter. And in fact,
you're in the charter.
so that the court can take notice of what's in the Villa Rica Charter. We have a certified copy of the Charter of the City of Villa Rica for the court should it decide that it wants to look over the charter in conjunction with the H.G. Brown case. The certification of the clerk is on the very first page. Here's how bad Villa Rica missed the boat. In executing the contract, the failures of the Villa Rica contract, three strikes and they missed them all. One, it was not authorized by the council before the mayor signed it. Two, it was not approved by a quorum of the council as the charter required. And three, it was not drafted by the city attorney or submitted to it. It was a bad case for the people who were trying to enforce that contract on the city of Villa Rica. City of Cumming charter does not contain those strictures. The plaintiff's misunderstanding of the Villa Rica case and how it applies deals with the distinction between a power that is granted generally and a power that is granted with these severe limitations as it was in that Villa Rica case. The city of Cumming in its charter, if it had been submitted to you, you could look at it and see that it is granted the power to purchase real property both generally and for water and sewer purposes. And when the power is granted to the city of Cumming generally, the city of Cumming is given the authority to determine how the city of Cumming wants to exercise it. And that is City of Atlanta versus McKinney, March 4th, 1995 case, 265 Georgia 161. It's a case that we cited in our brief. I have a copy of it for the court. If a local government is given the power generally to take an action and then you don't have these severe limitations like were present in the city of Villa Rica case, it's up to the local government to decide how the local government wants to exercise its power. How did the city of Cumming exercise its power? As we've already said, in conformity with the Johnson versus Board of Commissioners of Bibb County case. Went into executive session to discuss acquisition, voted to acquire the property in executive session. The property was then acquired, and as in the Johnson case, after acquisition, there was a vote to ratify the previous purchases. Only the city of Cumming did not wait until after suit was filed to ratify the purchases. It saw the roadmap, and it completed it the way that it was supposed to. Those were public meetings where the city of Cumming took these actions. March 20th was a public meeting, April 17th was a public meeting. It went into executive session for purposes authorized by the law to do things authorized by the law in conformity with the law and the case law interpreting it. The last part though, Judge, I believe is key. That after the acquisition, there was a vote to ratify the previous purchase. And the reason that I believe that is key is that contrary to the plaintiff's argument about the H.G. Brown case, the H.G. Brown case actually indicates the very last page, I think it's page 887. Does the court have a copy of the H.G. Brown case? I've got a copy of it here, Your Honor. I'll provide you with a copy of it. You need this one.
I've got it.
I figured you would. The plaintiff of the H.G. Brown case, Your Honor, was asking for the court to require, through mandamus, the city of Villa Rica to approve this contract. What they wanted the court to do is to mandate the city of Villa Rica to enter the contract on its official minutes, thereby validating it. The court recognizes that the city of Villa Rica took this action after the fact, or if it was forced to take this action after the fact, that then this contract would be enforceable against the city of Villa Rica. And on page, I think it's 887, is where the court recognizes that. Here, we don't have to deal with the issue of whether or not the city of Cumming has, after the fact, validated it, because it did. It did on April 17th, 2012, in an open and public meeting in front of everyone, including the plaintiff. The city of Cumming took action to say, we ratify that action that was previously taken. And as the H.G. Brown case notes at the very end of the opinion, if the city of Villa Rica had been forced to do that, the contract would have been validated The city of Cumming wasn't forced to do it. The city of Cumming chose to do it. The contract is validated. In other words, put it differently, plaintiff's complaint is moot because of the action that the city of Cumming took. Summarizing the charter issue with regard to plaintiff, in addition to the objection we raised about there not being a copy of the charter in the record, plaintiff's claim fails for a lack of standing, as I mentioned earlier, and plaintiff's claim fails for a lack of violation. In addition to the mootness argument, because it was subsequently approved. A few final issues, Judge, that frankly didn't fit elsewhere in my outline, so I wanted to put them here. Plaintiff's reply brief attempts to raise a red herring to confuse the court about what version of the Open Meetings Act applies when. The city of Cumming has never once said that on April 17th, 2012, that anything other than the 2012 version of the Open Meetings Act applies. Because frankly, as I mentioned earlier, that highlights the reason that we're right in this case, because after that date, a vote would have to be taken in public, but prior to that date, a vote could be taken in executive session. Plaintiff has made a lot of the fact that the city of Cumming went to executive session to discuss real property purchase under the old law, and that it can't vote to acquire when it goes into executive session for that purchase. That's just wrong. Under the Johnson versus Board of Commissioners of Bibb County case, the Court of Appeals noted that's exactly what the Bibb County did, and there was no problem with it. Plaintiff tries to say that I think that an attempt to negotiate and close on a contract on behalf of the city for less than the appraised value does not authorize the purchase of the property. I just think that's silly and it belies common sense. If you're telling someone to close on a contract to purchase property, closing a contract for property, that means purchase the property. Everyone understands that means purchase the property. And the key is, what's the intent of the city of Cumming there? And they're saying close on the contract, that means purchase the property.
What else could it have meant?
I can't think of what it would mean. Enter into a contract would mean to sign the contract. I think plaintiff wants you to believe that the only thing the mayor was authorized to do was enter into a contract. But if that's the case, the record would have said enter into a contract. Instead, it says that he was authorized to close on a contract. I don't see anything else that it can mean. And if the issue is with the word attempt to negotiate and close on a contract, if the issue is with the word attempt, then I think it's even more silly. What was the mayor supposed to do? Get to the closing table with pen in hand and say, whoa, fellas, I was only authorized to attempt this. I wasn't actually authorized to carry it out. Plaintiff's argument on that point just does not make any common sense. The authorization was there. The mayor carried it out. In conclusion, Your Honor, on the Open Meetings Act case, again, two reasons. Number one, statute of limitations. There's absolutely nothing that can save the plaintiff from the statute of limitations. And their attempt to invoke the statute of repose exposes a fundamental misunderstanding of the difference between a statute of repose and a statute of limitations. To invoke the statute of repose, plaintiff has to show that she, even though she was sitting in the room on April 17th, 2012, that she somehow didn't know about this until Tuesday, July 15th, 2012. 3 months. Plaintiff can't show that, so they cannot invoke the statute of repose. And because of that, the statute of limitations bars the action.
All right. Do I have a copy of the minutes of the meeting of April 17th?
You will.
You do, Your Honor. They're,
what
number? Number four?
Four. Okay. Yeah, I got it right here.
Here, Your Honor, is the certified copy.
And Your Honor, I'm happy to replace the certified copies if Mr. Tallant would be amenable with the plaintiff's exhibit 1 through 4, whatever is the easiest.
Okay.
Thank you.
Your Honor, if I could.
Well, is it, isn't it, is it, can we stipulate as to whether or not Ms. Tisdale was present at the meeting of April 17th?
We can, Your Honor, but as I will discuss, we cannot stipulate that she was in the executive session, which is going to be important to our argument.
Probably she was.
She was not in the executive session, Your Honor, but remember, the plaintiff's claim is that this action that was taken on April 17th, 2012, was a violation of the Open Meetings Act. I mean, the question is, when should she have discovered that there was something out there, Judge, that needed to be investigated, that needed to have a suit brought on it? And she was in the room on April 17th, 2012, and what the mayor said on April 17th, 2012, I see a couple
of things. What he said was in the minutes.
What he said was in the minutes. That's exactly right, Your Honor.
Right. It's a B.
And what he said was, negotiations have been held. If you look down a little bit farther, the purchase of this property had been previously authorized in executive session by the council. Mayor Gravitt requested ratification of the purchase of the 77 acres. He told everyone who was sitting there, and we have a stipulation now that Ms. Tisdale was there, that the purchase of the property had been previously authorized in executive session.
All right,
and the minutes of the March meeting were out there. They were approved at the April 17th meeting. That's when the March 20th minutes were approved, the one the plaintiff relies upon about how we went into executive session and how allegedly the city of Cumming did not have the right vote procedure taken. Those minutes were approved on April 17th. And they were out there for public consumption and had been the entire time from April 17th forward once they were approved. The plaintiff cannot survive the statute of limitations argument in this case. It also fails, Your Honor, as I mentioned previously, for lack of violation. The charter argument, again, first, plaintiff fails for lack of standing. She does not have standing to complain about this charter issue that she has raised regarding the city of Cumming. It also fails for lack of a violation for the reasons that we laid out before, including the fact that as the court recognized in H.G. Brown, if the city had been forced to take action in that case after the fact, it would have been ratified. The city of Cumming voluntarily took action. And what it boils down to is, Judge, plaintiff is not entitled to any relief in this case, certainly not an injunction. And they've talked about they want to discuss fees and that sort of thing. It's absolutely not entitled to any relief in this case.
Mr. Mott?
I was just going to provide the court with the citation you'd asked for related to whether the court or how the court can take judicial notice of a city ordinance or charter, and that's OCGA section 24-2-221, which provides that the court may take judicial notice upon presentation of a certified copy of the municipal record. In this case, it would be a charter. And that's the citation the court had asked for. I don't think Mr. Tallant provided that. I wanted to say that before Mr. Weber responded and allowed him to have that information as well. 24-221. Thank you, Your Honor.
Thank you, Your Honor. I thought it would be helpful to start out with the procedural standing statute of limitations issues first and then talk about the merits. Ms. Tisdale was at that March 20th meeting. What she was not at was the executive session. What she did do in order to try to find out what happened in that executive session was, pursuant to the Open Records Act, request a copy of the executive session minutes. Mr. Tallant's correct. The city does not have the obligation, but can provide those. They didn't. So she was left in the dark as to what happened in the executive session. She did not see those minutes. The statute of limitations, the statute of repose was approaching. And so we filed. At that point, we still hadn't seen the executive session minutes. You know when we saw them, Your Honor? November 19th, long after the lawsuit was filed, when the response to our motion for injunction was filed. Statute of repose clearly applies here, the 6-month statute of repose. We were left in the dark, not only at the time we filed this lawsuit, we had a credible good faith basis for filing, so we
filed in the dark.
As to what happened. The executive session minutes were not produced. We asked for them, they were not produced. We were left in that vacuum And as the 6 month, the longer the statute of repose was approaching, we went ahead and filed because that was all we could do. We didn't see those executive session minutes, which are exhibit two that we provided, until the response to the motion was filed. So we believe clearly the new, under the new Open Meetings Act, because we filed under the new Open Meetings Act, the 6 month statute of repose applies. So that's statute of limitations. Standing. Defendants have a question that Ms. Tisdale has standing under the Open Meetings Act. Clearly, a non-resident does. And the provision of the city charter, they have contested standing as to the city charter. The provision of the city charter is analogous. All actions of the council have to take place in a public meeting. Our argument is simple, that for the same reasons that Ms. Tisdale has standing under the Open Meetings Act, because everybody has a right to a public meeting, everybody can attend it, so everybody has a right to have it be public, that she too has standing for the charter provision. And that pans out, if you look at, for example, courtroom access cases, you know, citizens have a right to access to a courtroom. It may be this court, but if any of these folks are not residents of this county, they still have standing to assert a right to a public hearing. In the same way, Ms. Tisdale has a right under the city charter to assert a right to a public meeting, because everybody gets to go, resident or no, so if it's violated, everybody has standing, resident or no. That's what the logic is of the Open Meetings Act. One can be from out of state and file a claim under the Open Meetings Act. So that's our response to standing. And, you know, Your Honor, I talked to Your Honor for about half of my time about one provision. And it was 50-14-4A. I just kept talking about it. I talked about four ways in which it was violated. And I just thought that we were going to hear from the defendants about what 50-14-4A says and means. And it hasn't changed. It was there under the old Open Meetings Act, under the new Open Meetings Law. It's the key to the problem with their executive session in this case. It says that there has to be specific reasons stated for the closure. Now, we are not asserting, and it's ambiguous under the Act, but I think the logic of Mr. Tallant's explanation clearly makes sense. The minutes do not have to reflect the specific trap. We agree with him on that, because otherwise the purpose of the executive session would be frustrated. But the statute does say specific reasons have to be given. We know that there were five things discussed in that executive session. And if you look at that one sentence, it doesn't talk about five things. But more critically, Mr. Tallant is right that there are other provisions of the Open Meetings Act that allow for unanimous votes to not reflect the names of each person voted. But 50-14-4A, that this side was silent about, Your Honor, says the minutes shall reflect the names of the members present and the names of those voting for closure. The minutes, in this case, of that March 20th meeting, one sentence, Exhibit 1, don't even say that a vote was taken. They don't even say that a vote was taken. I should have brought them up with me, Your Honor, and I didn't. Here we go. Mayor Gravitt announced. Not a vote, but Mayor Gravitt announced the need for an executive session to discuss issues concerning the purchase of real property. I don't see any council members' names. I don't see a reflection of a vote having been taken. I don't see in the words of the statute that the minutes reflect the names of the members present and the names of those voting for closure. I don't see that. Nor do I see, as the statute requires, the specific reasons for closure, because there must have been five, because there are five things discussed in the executive session. We don't know what the other four were. But we know that there was a fifth, which was ours. It's not what the executive session, the minutes that allow for them to go into executive session state. So that's the problem. It's the problem that they're silent about, that we keep talking about, That executive session, no matter what they decided, they could have voted on it or they could have just discussed it. Doesn't matter. They didn't go into the executive session properly. Whatever they did in there, doesn't matter. Because they didn't do it right. And that's the heart of our argument. They didn't do it right on March 20th. They did, if they hadn't entered into the transaction, do it right on April 17th. But by then, they had already entered into the deal. And you can't put the cart before the horse. Villa Rica says that. It says there is an open meetings violation if you approve something after it's been done. Simple as that. Cart before the horse. So whatever happened in that executive session, we didn't know about even the minutes of it until after we filed this lawsuit. That's the only time that we got them. That's why the statute of limitations of the statute of repose applies. We didn't even see them. But what's critical is whatever happened in that meeting on March 20th in the executive session doesn't count because they didn't go into it properly. What does count is that the mayor entered into a deal before the city council legitimately approved the deal a day later. And the remedy is, but the remedy is that Villa Rica says it is. No one will
ask you a question. I'm looking now at your complaint, and I would ask that you make sure that I get a copy of the complaint. But it says in here, plaintiff seeks a declaration and an injunction declaring all actions identified herein of the city of Cumming prior to approval by the city, by the Cumming City Council, ultra vires null and void and enjoining these transactions.
Right.
Now, if the city of Cumming City Council approved the transaction, even though it was after the transaction took place, would that not make it valid?
No, and that's kind of what Villa Rica says. I mean, what happened was it was a contract there, and it's not a real estate purchase, but there was a contract entered into, and then after that, the council approves it. And the court says that the contract was invalid, null and void, because it was entered into before the meeting. Now, the city certainly can go back, have another meeting, and approve a transaction and then enter into a transaction. They, with the horse in front of the cart, but they can't
validate something's already taken place.
Right, right. What they have to do is they have to, the transaction's declared null and void by your honor. Then they have a meeting where they approve a transaction, then they enter into a transaction. Horse first, cart second. If your honor has no further questions, thank you.
Very briefly, your honor. Mr. Weber,
chance to come back, Mr. Weber.
Mr. Weber is wrong in two regards versus about the H.G. Brown case. Number one, he said it's an open meetings case, and then it says if you don't have an open meeting, then the contract is null and void. H.G. Brown doesn't even cite the Open Meetings Act that I can find. It's about the city of Villa Rica charter. And the court asked, can the city go back, assuming it was void, which we dispute, assuming it was void, can the city go back after the fact and fix that issue?
Ratify.
And it can. And that gets down to the plaintiff's misunderstanding about being given a power, as the city of Villa Rica did, that is laden with those strictures that you have to comply with, versus the power the city of Cumming has, which is open, broad. No mention of how it goes about going, entering into contracts. There's no mention in the city of Cumming charter about that the city attorney has to approve it. The strictures that were in the Villa Rica case aren't present. And contrary to plaintiff's argument, this is the other reason he's wrong about the Villa Rica case. The Villa Rica case was about a land purchase. The city of Villa Rica purchased right away and agreed to do a bunch of other things. And then it got to a point in the contract that didn't want to play ball anymore, and so the city of Villa Rica said, we don't want to do this. And again, at the end of the case, on page 887 of the city of Villa Rica case, the court said, was it the Supreme Court?
Yes.
Yes, the Supreme Court said, if the city of Villa Rica had been made through mandamus to enter this on its minutes, approve it, then it would have been valid. So Mr. Weber's wrong. The City of Villa Riga case on page 887 actually indicates that you can have a after-the-fact approval, which is exactly what the City of Cumming did in this case. Mr. Weber wants to talk about how the March 20th, he focused again on the March 20th minutes and how they don't reflect the names of those people who were voting for and against the executive session. He stood here and he said that Ms. Tisdale was there. Certainly the minutes were approved on April 17th. The world knew the status of the minutes of the March 20th meeting, Your Honor, no later than April 17th. And yet he wants to claim that they, for some reason, could not bring that case until the statute of repose was about to run out. And here's the key, Judge. The fact that they're arguing is a violation of the Open Meetings Act is a vote that took place, or as he says, he contends, a vote that didn't take place on March 20th, 2012. That wasn't an executive session. The announcement of why we were going into executive session wasn't made in executive session. That was all done in public. That was all done in front of everyone. The minutes were out there reflecting it. Why did the plaintiff wait almost 7 months after March 20th to bring the action? There is absolutely no reason, no justification for it. None at all. Plaintiff wants to claim that, okay, well, we didn't have access to the executive session minutes, what was actually said, what was actually done in executive session. Remember, the complaint the plaintiff has is about how we went into executive session. That was all done in a public meeting. Once the executive session was in there, once we were in executive session, the City of Cumming followed the Johnson versus Bibb County Board of Commissioners case to the T. There is no violation in executive session. It's not there. We actually produced those with our brief to show what the City of Cumming did in executive session. We thought once the plaintiff sees that this was authorized in executive session, this will go away, because they certainly can't claim they're within the statute of limitations for the public vote that was taken on March 20th.
Because I haven't had a chance to study the City of Villa Rica case, but I'm reading page 887 on.
And yes, sir.
It says, while this conclusion may at first blush, well, that's what my conclusion is at first blush, so I haven't studied it. But it seems to say that it's that the action of the City of Villa Rica was invalid, and yet then they had a meeting and they decided that they would not go along with the transaction that they had already done illegally, and the Supreme Court held that they could do that. Well, conversely, if the City of Villa Rica had validated what they had done illegally, would that make it then valid? The Supreme Court held they could invalidate what they had done up to that point. They could invalidate what they had done illegally. Then the flip side of that is, could they then validate what they had done illegally? I don't know the answer. I haven't.
Your Honor, it's the penultimate paragraph. If the court looks at the next to last paragraph, you're hitting on what I'm saying, and I'll read it. Accordingly, because the city acted without any power, and again, we're dealing in a difference without whether or not somebody has power, we conclude the trial court did not abuse its discretion in denying mandamus relief, and here's what that relief would have required, that compelled the city to enter the contract in its official minutes, thereby validating it. In other words, the City of Villa Rica could have validated the contract after the fact. That's what the City of Cumming did. That's why there is no charter violation that we're dealing with. That's why there's no Open Meetings Act violation on April 17th, because the City of Cumming took that action. And again, for anything that happened at the March 20th meeting, it's the public portion of the March 20th meeting plaintiff is complaining about. And the statute of limitations has absolutely, without a doubt, expired. Thank you, Judge.
All right, now.
Your Honor, I was just going to.
Sure.
Very, very briefly.
You always have the last
I was asserting my right, Your Honor. I just wanted to point out the counsel stated that the Villa Rica case did not address the open meetings issue. I just want to point the court to page 821. I'll just read the sentence.
Wait, let me get 821.
Of the Georgia site, or 821 of the Georgia site, or 886 of the Southeast. And it's head note 7. And they're talking about the contract, and then they say, the contract was not authorized by the council before being signed by the mayor. Moreover, the contract was not considered by the council in conjunction with the open public, with an open public meeting as required by the Georgia Code, and then they say the open meetings law. So I just wanted to clarify that it was a decision both under the charter, that it was impermissible under the charter because the mayor jumped the gun, cart before the horse, and under the Open Meetings Act, same thing, entered into a deal before a public meeting. And that's all I got. Thank you.
Now, I would like to get a copy of the complaint and your answer. And is there anything else that I need, any other exhibits that I need? And what I'm going to have to do is, when I finish, I will file all these exhibits with the clerk. So the clerk's going to have, in the event there's an appeal, the clerk's got to have these exhibits. And so I'll send all these to the clerk. And Mr. Court Reporter, here's my name and address. And as soon as I get this record, I will not invoke a statute of repose, but I will go ahead and get some kind of order out.
Thank you, Your Honor. And we're happy to review the record and make sure that everything is here.
Yeah, make sure I've got everything I need to have.
These are your exhibits that you want us to make sure on. And you want us just to provide you with copies of everything else?
That I don't have. Okay. That you both can agree that will be admitted in the case, and I will send all of those to the court.
Yeah, Your Honor, I think we've, on the plaintiff's side, we have the complaint, the initial motion.
Sure, I got it. Okay. I don't have a complaint, I don't think.
Okay. Your Honor, if it's easy, it's just to be safe, we can just each give you a complete set of our side.
I think that's probably the easiest thing for us to do.
Okay, well, why don't we give all of that then to the court reporter for inclusion, or the clerk? And then you can give me everything that I need to have.
I think that's it. Let me just put my blue through my stuff.
So you want a paper version of it, or we can email it to you, or whatever it is.
I'm 81 years old. I read.
We'll get you both.
You're not smiling, are you?
No.
I'm trying to get into the 21st century, but it's difficult. I scanned something once, but I never could figure out how I did it.
Your Honor, I had an internet free speech case before Judge Shoup in federal court, and when the internet first came out, and he asked us how to turn on his computer.
Yeah, I understand. I understand. We've been Windows. What is the one before Windows 7? It was Windows something.
SP
or something like that. And we now, because my computer went bad, we now use Windows 7, and I haven't mastered it yet. But I'm working on it.
The only thing we're replacing is the certified copy of the March 20, 2012. So no, I think we're good.
Yeah.
I think we're good.
Okay. And you're going to give me also the charges.
The charges, yeah. Well, yeah. Yes.
Anything else?
Nothing from the plaintiffs, Your Honor.
Well, let me say to the lawyers, you know, this is my 58th year to be a lawyer, and I still appreciate good lawyers doing good presentations. I want to thank you both.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And Mr. Miles, too, for whatever you
said. Thank you, Your Honor.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you.
The court board has asked this. Should she make copies of these exhibits and attach them to the transcript, or shall I just make sure the clerk gets them? The easiest thing, cheapest thing for you would be for me to just hand them to the clerk.
That works for us.
I'm fine with that.
Okay.
Thank you.
We in recess, Your Honor?
Yeah.
Thanks very much. You have a safe at home.
Thank you. Did you tend to say that?
No. If anything, it's probably just about the opportunity to play as well.
We've got one guy who's 86. I'm 81. Oh, well, there's another 84. 81. And one guy's in his 70s. We have five matches. We need to pin that one of us in the state of the six. But we're still playing everybody.
I don't get to play very much anymore. I need to start picking it back up. It's good exercise.
Well, for a lot of reasons.
Thank you.
I'm
Do you mind invoicing us?
No, I don't.